In the entire history of college basketball, fewer than 50 teams have completed a perfect season. Even the Luau Cinder-led UCLA teams accomplished this feat only once. In 1971, two teams, Penn and Marquette, made history. This is the story of Penn's unbeaten season. The foundations of the 71 season were actually laid two seasons before, on December 7th, 1968, when Coach Dick Harter, beset with personnel problems, started an all-sophomore backcourt, Dave Wall and Steve Bilski. Those two, along with soph Jim Wolf, helped lead the team to a 15-10 record and won eight of the last 10 games for a third-place Ivy League finish behind Princeton and Columbia. The highlight of that season came on February 8, 1969, when the Quakers defeated Columbia 91-81, beating a Lion team that featured All-Americans Jim McMillan and Haywood Dotson. While the varsity was building its nucleus, the freshman team under Coach Dick Phelps was compiling an unprecedented 21-0 record. While the varsity put its season together, the coaches and fans sat back in anticipation of the day when Corky Calhoun and Bob Morse would join the team. The next season, 1969-1970, was the dawn of greatness for Penn basketball as the team finished the regular season 25-1, losing only to Purdue in the semifinals of the Holiday Festival in New York. The Big Five title was won outright for the first time ever, and the Quakers copped the Ivy League crown, going 14-0 in league play. Dave Wall, Steve Bilski, Jim Wolf, Corky Calhoun, and Bob Morse, three juniors and two sophomores, started every game, molding themselves into a cohesive unit. John Kohler played the role of super sub, frequently coming off the bench to impassively can a few 30-footers to get the offense going. The team directed by coaches Harter, Ray Edelman, Phelps, and Ray Carrazzo developed a machine-like precision on offense, although it did not become what Harter wished, the best fast-breaking team in the East. Its defensive style developed distinctive characteristics as well, as the coaches taught man-to-man defense to perfection and installed a 1-2-2 trap pressing defense that was used to harass and quicken the pace of the games against weak teams. In fact, defense became the team's strongest asset as Wall, Calhoun, and Wolf developed into the finest defensive guard, forward, and center in the East, individually taking on future pros like McMillan, Petrie, Mount, Hummer, and Murphy. Through the never-ending pressure of that great season, the players learned poise and toughness. Wall and Bilski developed the ice-in-the-veins phenomenon to the ultimate as the two guards took control in the closing minutes of every close game, dribbling away the clock and uncannily making every pressure-free throw. That 69-70 season had its own highlights that began in the very first game, as the Quakers set a scoring record of 115 points while outgunning overmatched Muhlenberg. Other big wins were over top 10 rated Villanova in the Big Five and Princeton and Columbia in the Ivy League. Coach Phelps' freshmen did exceedingly well again, posting a record of 13-5 and repeating as Big Five champions. The freshman team also developed some strong individual talent, notably Phil Hankerson, who set a record by scoring 429 points, and Craig Littlepage and Steve Vittori, both local high school talents. The 69-70 season ended in the NCAA tournament with a stunning 79-69 upset loss to Niagara in the opening round. Prospects were bright for the next winter, though, with all five starters returning and super freshmen coming up. The stage was set for the perfect season.
We've all planned or hoped or worked for a perfect season from the beginning. Every college team does.
WXPN Sports presents The Perfect Season, the story of the 1970-71 University of Pennsylvania basketball team.
I think Corky Calhoun is too good a basketball player not to score consistently in the high teens at least.
Al Kotler inbounds to Calhoun. He's going to bring it all the way in himself. Corky, 8 seconds to go.
And when I got the ball out, I dribbled down. I couldn't find any open man. And so I noticed I had the ball at the top of the key with about 3 seconds left on the clock. So.
To Hankinson, 6 seconds to go. Calhoun has it.
So I shot it up, hoped it would go in, and luckily it did.
Jump shot, up, good.
Narrated by John Facenda. Produced by Steve Seltzer, Steve Glasser, and Joe Coplin.
I think the important thing about this year's team is that we do have a very deep bench, and not like a lot of other teams, they have a lot of talent. We're able to use our depth well.
Edited and written by Andy Wender, Chuck Torrey, and the members of the WXPN sports staff. Created by Dave Spector.
The defending Ivy League and the Big Five champs opened the 1970-71 season on December 1st against an improved Rutgers squad at the Palestra.
Jumping for Pennsylvania, Jimmy Wolf. For Rutgers will be Gene Armstead. Steve Hansa, the referee tonight, ready to throw up the ball. The tap is controlled by Pennsylvania. Dave Wolf gets a tap from Jim Wolf and brings it across the timeline into the front court.
The Quakers started off sharply with a tenacious defense, defeated the Scarlet Knights 85-71. Penn built up an early 24-11 lead on the hot outside shooting of Bob Morse and Dave Wall. Meanwhile, center Jim Wolf kept the ball away from Gene Armstead, Rutgers star, 6'9 sophomore for most of the first half. This, combined with the outstanding 57% shooting of the Quakers, gave them a 48-34 lead at halftime. After intermission, Moore stayed hot, and Steve Bilski hit from the floor and from the line with great consistency, as Penn was never in real danger. Morse was high man with 27, and Steve Bilski threw in 26. Although Coach Harter was fairly pleased with the performance, he was disappointed that Corky Calhoun tallied only 4 points and 4 rebounds, and Penn was out-rebounded 43-33. As the season began, rebounding seemed to be the team's only visible weakness. The Quakers next traveled to Annapolis to meet the midshipmen and were almost upset by Navy's pattern offense. The freeze proved to be very frustrating, and it was not until midway through the first half that Penn broke the deadlock. Dave Wall hit 3 long jump shots and helped make the lead 26-19 at the half. Navy had possession for more than two-thirds of the half and took only 13 shots as they were unable to penetrate Penn's man-to-man. The second half saw the same deliberate offense keep the middies in the game until the final 5 minutes, when Penn transformed a slim 46-40 lead into a 59-45 victory margin. Wall was high man with 20 points. In the third game on the 10th of December, a Madison Square Garden audience saw an awesome Penn performance as the Quakers crushed NYU 91-62. For the first time, Penn dominated the boards with an overwhelming 67-33 margin. The star of the game was 6'8 soft Phil Hankinson, a New York product playing his first game in the Garden. We asked Phil what it was like to return before his hometown fans.
Well, it was really a big thrill, playing in a place that you'd watch maybe close to 500 games, and by the time, you know, you reach the age that you are. And I was really excited and just happy that I was able to do well.
Phil came off the bench midway through the first half and helped the Red and Blue gain a 15-point halftime advantage. Hankinson continued his fine play in the second half as he put together a 19-point night and a game-high 15 rebounds. The Earthquakers contributed 49 points and 35 rebounds as they played the final 10 minutes of the game and brought glory to all the super subs who make Penn as deep a team as any in the nation.
We were having a very successful season, but Ohio State was looked at as one of the powers in the Big Ten. In fact, I believe they later on won the Big Ten championship, so it was going to be a real challenge for us to win that game. It was on the road in Columbus, Ohio. And for me, it was especially nice because that was one of the few times my dad could actually come to the game. He drove to the game with two of my three brothers.
The Quakers next traveled to Columbus, Ohio, with a 3-0 record to face Ohio State. Penn fans had known long before the season began that the Columbus trip would be the toughest game of the early season. Ohio State was hungrily eyeing a possible Big Ten title, which they subsequently won. The Buckeyes were led by all-Big Ten guard Jim Clemens, sophomore guard Al Horniak, rated a super by Coach Harter, and 7-foot soft center Luke Whitty. The 12,600 screaming fans at St. John Arena saw an incredible defensive struggle in the first half that was marked by numerous turnovers. The Quakers trailing at the half, 29-28. In the second half, the state defense was just as tough, and Penn could not penetrate. Penn was down by 7 with 6:45 remaining. Then Dave Wall re-entered the game and lit the fire to the Quaker offense.
Offensive shot knocked off the list by Calhoun. Rebound, Whitty, around it in.
Aggressive play underneath as Ohio State gets three chances and scores on the third one. Lead again, 60-55, 5 points for the Buckeyes.
Phil Hankinson calling for the ball on the left side. He wants to take advantage of the shorter Seekman. Now he has it. Goes back to Calhoun. Quirky, top of the key. Good!
Penn's shooting is finally back, but they haven't been able to get the ball. They haven't been able to force turnovers and cut the lead. It's been going between 3 and 5.
Clemens drives to the left baseline, takes a shot, around no good. Hankinson gets a big rebound for Penn. Filski ahead of the pack to Wall, but it's a bad pass. Dave controls, lays it up, no good. We're going to have goaltending. Goaltending call on Seekman. And that will be a basket for Dave Wall.
First time Pennsylvania's had a good fast break all game as Hankinson quickly got it out to Bilski. Bilski's pass to Wall led him a little bit too much, but he slowed down, got the shot up. Goaltending was called. The lead now 1 point for Ohio State.
The ball was not above the rim, but it was blocked against the glass by Seekman, which is not allowed. Penn trailing only by one, 60-59. Wager goes in, throws it up, no good. Battle for the rebound, out of bounds. Penn's ball, 60-59. The Quakers trailing by one, 3:55 left in the game. Miner getting ready to come back in for the Buckeyes. And he's going to come in for Seekman, I believe. That's right. They want the taller man back on Phil Hankinson. So Penn with a chance to go back into the lead here. They trail by one, 3:52 to go. We remind you, you're listening to this game on WXPN in Philadelphia. Bilski in the backcourt with Wall, guarded by Horniak. Left side to Hankinson, guarded by Miner. High post Calhoun to Wall, fakes once, now takes it. It's good. 18-footer by Dave Wall, and Penn into the lead.
After the brief Penn comeback, baskets by Whitty and Horniak regained the lead for the Buckeyes at 64-61, with 2:10 remaining, where we pick up the action.
Quirky makes the first one, makes the second one, Penn trailing by one, 1:54 to go. We'll see if Ohio State's going to freeze it. Clemens brings it up. Wolf has fallen down, but now gets back to pick up his man. Miner on the right side. Penn's going to be in the man-to-man, so they'll be able to put pressure on if Ohio State tries to freeze. And we're going to have a whistle and a timeout for Ohio State. Penn comes out.
Second, 5 seconds.
And almost as a turnover, it is a turnover. A turnover by Ohio State as the inbounds pass was just completely thrown away by Miner. Norm?
Miner couldn't find an open man. Finally threw a desperation pass. Sort of a wreck turn desperation and went out of bounds all the way across the court. Pennsylvania has a chance now to come back into the lead with only a minute and a half to go in the ballgame.
Big turnover by Miner. He threw that inbounds pass completely away. Wall has on the right side into Calhoun. Quirky to the hoop. Lays it up and in. A big field goal by Quirky Calhoun. 10 up by 1, 65-64. 1:24 left in the ballgame.
In the final 50 seconds, Steve Bilski, who was having an off-night shooting, took control of the game and dribbled his way through the Buckeyes until he was fouled. He converted 2 1-and-1 situations to put the game on ice for Penn and ending one of the most dramatic games of the season and making believers out of many astonished Midwest fans. Wall, Morse, and Calhoun scored 55 points among them to give Penn its first win against a Big Ten team in seven outings. Coach Dick Harter called the 71-64 triumph the best win ever. The Quaker comeback against a strong Ohio State club had indeed been brilliant, and along with other comebacks, helped develop a certain mystique of invincibility around the red and blue squad. That air of supreme confidence in their own abilities pervaded the Quakers and made them an unbeatable team in the close game.
A lot of history associated not only with the building, but with the Ohio State program. And to go out there and to beat a very, very good Ohio State team in their building really did give us the feeling that we were a team that could compete against anybody in the country.
It meant a lot in terms of being able to beat a well-recognized team, but I don't know that we really had plans to be an undefeated team that particular year, but that one happened to fall in place, and without it, obviously, we wouldn't have been undefeated. So it was really more of the chance to show that we could be real competitive with a very strong team.
It seemed that Penn would be put to the test again as they opened their Big Five season against LaSalle. Like the Quakers, the Explorers were undefeated, led by their brilliant 6'7 All-American Ken Durrett. Nonetheless, Penn got off to an explosive start, and by the time Durrett and his teammates reorganized, the game was out of reach. During the opening 7 minutes, the Red and Blue used an awesome fast-break offense throw.
Shot is no good. The rebound tapped back outside. The cannon drives the lane, blocked by Wolf. Rebound, Pennsylvania. Dave Wall. Nabilski, 3-on-2 to Wall in the middle, up and good. 3-on-2 fast break executed to perfection. Here comes Fields the other way for LaSalle. Gets to the foul line, blocked from behind by Wall. Walsh with the rebound, no good. Rebound, Bob Morse, Pennsylvania. Outlet pass to Bilski. Quaker's going to run again. Bilski has Calhoun and Wolf all alone underneath. Jimmy goes in.
Guards Bilski and Wall dominated the scoring as the Quakers spurred it to an 18-5 lead. The style of play continued throughout the first half, as Bilski and Wall had 29 between them by halftime. Penn sparkled on defense also, as Wolf held Durrett to only 4 field goals in 10 attempts. Penn took a 49-26 lead to the locker room. In the second half, with the game out of reach, Penn substituted liberally. The play got ragged, and Durrett managed most of his 31 points during this time. LaSalle never got back in the game, though, losing by a score of 107-88. Coach Harter said after the game that the first half was the best he had ever seen Penn play. Coming off this devastating performance against LaSalle, Penn faced a tough field in the Quaker City tournament at Philadelphia Spectrum.
One of my favorite memories from that season 50 years ago was playing in the Quaker City tournament in Spectrum in Philadelphia. And in the opening round, we played a pretty good Syracuse team. They featured 2 outstanding players, Bill Smith, 6'11 center, and Greg Coles, a guard, who were both averaging over 20 points a game. A week before, we had defeated LaSalle's team with Kenny Durrett, and we were off for a week. The opening round of the tournament was on the day after Christmas. So we came out pretty flat and lethargic. And I had a good offensive game. I was I scored 30 points and 17 rebounds, which were season highs for the team. And we got the game into overtime, and then we pulled away. And with the foul shooting and dribbling of Steve Bilski and Dave Wall, we came away with the win. And that enabled us to remain undefeated for the rest of the regular season.
In the opening round against a surprisingly good Syracuse team featuring 6'11 center Bill Smith, Penn was flat, and only the outstanding player Bob Morse, who finished with a career-high 30 points and 17 rebounds, kept the Quakers in the game. Morse's heroics helped Penn overcome a 7-point deficit late in the contest and tie the score, sending the game into overtime. Steve Bilski's 10 points in the extra period gave Penn an 85-77 victory. The second round pitted Pennsylvania against Western Athletic Conference representative Utah. Morse again played brilliantly, scoring 27 and getting 13 rebounds as the Quakers won 86-78. The win moved Penn into the finals against the Big Five rival Temple, which had defeated St. Joseph's en route to the title game. Coach Harry Litwack used a zone defense, forcing the Quakers to shoot from the outside.
I had been disappointed in how I was shooting the two previous games in that tournament. So I hopped in my little VW bug early that afternoon, the next of the game, and I drove over to the Spectrum from the Penn campus. Didn't know if I could get in, but I was able to get in. There were really no lights on. It was very dimly lit up in the things, and the workman didn't mind. I told him I wanted to just shoot around. I had a ball with me. So I spent about a half hour, 45 minutes, just shooting on kind of the dark court until I thought I'd figured out, what I wasn't doing well. And as it turned out, it worked for me because I shot really well in that game. I think, like you said, I had 25, but I hit a number of outside shots early in the game, I think, which opened it up.
Dave Wall and Steve Bilski led the Pennsylvanian onslaught, combining for 34 points as they shot well against the Owl zone. Penn dominated the boards 52-32 while copping the Quaker City championship game by a convincing 76-55 margin. The crowning touch was added to Penn's tournament performance when Bob Morse was named the tourney's most valuable player. Morse talked about the team and this personal honor.
Well, it has to be a big thrill for me. I'd never played in the Spectrum before, and coming down in a big court like this, it's really the second best Christmas tournament. Has to be a big thrill for me. Well, I think we're going really strong at this point. After having a rough game against Syracuse in the opening round, we sort of played a lot better against Utah. And then the Temple game was kind of even, although we did pull away at the end. And I think we can do pretty well for this whole year, especially in the Ivy League and Big Five.
With the Quaker City title won, Penn now moved into Ivy League competition against the top three contenders, Princeton, Harvard, and Dartmouth. As Coach Harter put it, our kids have known since last spring that this is the week that we have been pointing for Princeton, Harvard, and Dartmouth, all on the road. Returning to Jadwin Gym at Princeton, site of Penn's disappointing NCAA loss to Niagara the previous year, the Quakers struggled a bit before defeating Princeton 70-62. Led by an outstanding pair of sophomore guards, Brian Taylor and Ted Menakis, the pesky Tigers rallied in the second half and cut an 11-point Penn lead to 4. The Quakers regained the momentum, however, as Bilski, Wall, and Calhoun combined to sink 13 free throws late in the game to ice the victory. The Quakers' next journey to Cambridge to meet Harvard, another team featuring a pair of super sophomores, center Floyd Lewis and guard James Brown.
Our group, we couldn't grow our hair any longer than half an inch. No beards, no mustaches, no facial hair, you know. And so one day, before we're going to play Harvard, Dick calls us in, and Ray Edelman, one of the assistant coaches, are sitting there. And he calls me and Steve Bilski in, and they start to berate us that our play is slipping because our hair has grown an eighth of an inch longer. Dick starts to go that, you know, the discipline is slipping on our team, and it's because of you guys. You let your hair grow an eighth of an inch longer. And then Dick really got caught up that whole week that not just that we could lose discipline if we lose to Harvard, but discipline is the foundation for civilization. And Dick was getting to the point that if we lose this game, civilization is going to crumble. I mean, what will we have left? And you think I'm kidding, but I'm not. I mean, Dick was dead serious about this. And for us, we knew that if we lost, the practices were going to get even harder. And none of us could imagine that because they were the hardest practices we'd gone through. We were so much more afraid of Dick Harter's practices than playing Harvard.
Playing what Harter later termed our worst half of the season, Penn shot only 25% from the floor and trailed the Crimson at halftime 35-29. The second half was a different story, though, as Penn shot a blistering 69% from the floor, hit on 16 of 18 free throws while scoring 52 points. Phil Hankinson, subbing for the ill Bobby Morse, provided the spark as Penn downed Harvard 81-62, thanks to a second half described by Coach Harter as absolutely the best half we have played since I've been at Penn. The sophomore forward said,
"Well, this is a really big win for us, and makes me feel doubly good, the fact that I could contribute so much to it. Harvard was one of the contenders for the Ivy League title, and beating them away on their home court really had to mean a lot to us. And the fact that I could do so much towards that win really makes me feel good."
The nation's fifth-ranked team had now run its record to 10-0 by winning its 16th straight Ivy League game and 28th regular season outing in succession as it prepared to visit Hanover, New Hampshire. With the temperature at game time hovering around zero, the Quakers met Dartmouth in a regionally televised game.
You know, in those days, we were so good, it was rare that we ever felt before a game we could lose it. And especially in the Ivy League, except for Princeton, there was never a game where we ever had any doubt about what the result was going to be before the game.
Behind the hot shooting of Wall and Morse, Penn built a 48-33 halftime lead. The Quakers continued their fine shooting in the second half, quickly opening up a 26-point margin as Coach Harter again brought in the Earthquakers. Ron Billingsley talked about Penn's super subs.
"I think the important thing about this year's team is that we do have a very deep bench, and not like a lot of other teams, they have a lot of talent. We're able to use our depth well. Everybody plays together, nobody's trying to be the one big scoring star, and provides for a lot of team unity."
The final score was 92-77 as Pennsylvania returned home, having swept the top three Ivy League pretenders to the throne. Penn's second Big Five opponent was St. Joseph's, entering the contest with a 7-4 slate. The Quakers controlled the first half, gradually increasing its lead, which reached 13 at one point. Jim Wolfe did a good job in his matchup with the Hawks' 6'8 sophomore Mike Banton. The Quaker defense forced St. Joe into committing 13 turnovers and at the half led 33-23. After the intermission, St. Joseph's patiently whittled down the Quakers' lead until with 5:14 remaining, the score read Penn 50, St. Joe 48. With each team playing deliberately, careful not to make mistakes, less than a minute remained when a Hawk basket cut the lead to 1 at 57-56. Walls 1-1 with 50 seconds remaining gave Penn a little breathing room, and Calhoun hit two free throws as the Quakers staggered away with a tough 62-58 victory. Accuracy on the foul line down the stretch had again been the key, as the poised red and blue at one point sank 14 free throws in a row. The winning mystique was once more in evidence as the Quakers again played just well enough to win. Dick Harter's father had died a few days before the January 16th Manhattan game, but the Penn mentor was on the Podesta bench for the opening tap. Manhattan missed its first five shots and 9 of its first 10 as the Quakers rolled up an early 14-point lead and led at the half 48-32. Penn had no trouble the rest of the way, coasting to a 91-68 victory. Ron Billingsley, before leaving the game with a twisted knee, electrified the crowd with 4 spectacular tip-ins and grabbed 7 rebounds. All 14 Quakers saw action, 12 scored. Temple will be tougher the second time around, warned Dick Harter. The Owls had just handed powerful Fordham its first defeat of the year and were looking to do the same to Penn. Temple didn't manage a field goal until 6.5 minutes had gone by. But the Quakers were not hitting from the outside and the game remained close. Both teams committed numerous turnovers, and at the half, Penn trailed 22-19, as they were having much difficulty penetrating Temple's 2-3 and 3-2 zone defenses. Dave Wall's 1,000th point of his collegiate career tied the score at 23. Moments later, Morse got a basket and Penn led 26-25. But the Owls hung tough. With 8:36 to go in the game, the Quakers finally took control. Bob Morse hit a jumper. Dave Wall followed with a layup and then hit Craig Littlepage for what became a big three-point play. Suddenly, Penn led by 9, 47-38. The Owls narrowed it to 6, but Wall and Bilski's baskets, plus Littlepage's free throw and layup, gave Penn a commanding 58-44 lead and ultimately a 62-48 victory. Harter called the play of Littlepage the difference in the game. In a three-minute period down the stretch, Craig scored 6 points, grabbed 3 rebounds, and had a steal. The 6'7 sophomore from Cheltenham said,
"Well, I think I played pretty good tonight, but I guess if you want to term it, you know, with best games, I guess it has been my best game so far this season, but I'm still far from satisfied. Basically, I think we have a lot of things to work on as a team, and I think when, you know, I talk about improving myself, I talk about improving defensively, maybe rebounding a little more, and offensively, I think I have a lot of work to do also."
Penn was now 3-0 in the Big Five competition, and all eyes were turning to the upcoming game, a Big Five match with Coach Jack Kraft and his big Villanova Wildcats.
All the Villanova games, we had great respect for each other, both teams. They were very competitive. They were usually a nationally ranked team every year also. And the one thing I loved about our team and our guys was we didn't panic. If we got down, you know, nobody started, you know, trying to win it all by themselves or something. And I think we came back in that game just by executing and playing our game. I think we got up 8 or 10 points. Maybe even 12 points at that point, and just kind of, you know, won the game.
Pennsylvania and Villanova in the game people have waited to see ever since the Palestra schedule was published this year.
A victory over Villanova would sew up a second consecutive Big Five championship for the Red and Blue. Howard Porter in company with some fine rebounding at both ends of the court built a first half lead for the Cats. Bob Morse picked up 3 personal fouls after only 6 minutes of play and spent the rest of the half on the bench. Hank Simontowski dominated the early scoring with some hot outside shooting. In the second half, trailing 44-36, the Quakers began their comeback. After a Wildcat fast break gave the mainliners their largest lead of the contest, 8 points.
Calhoun gets position on Smith, and Smith makes the play. Calhoun gets it back, fires over his head! Calhoun
started it off with a soft layup. The Penn defense forced Villanova into taking some bad shots while the Quakers ran off 3 baskets to bring them within 1, 47-46. After a Howard Porter foul shot, Jim Wolfe hit 2 free throws to tie things up at 48. Bob Morse, who came back to score 15 second half points, popped from the outside, putting Penn ahead 50-48 with 13:30 remaining, a lead they never relinquished. Villanova then switched to a man-to-man from their patented ball zone defense. Both Steve Bilski and Coach Harter expressed surprise at the change.
Full court to Bilski. Good. And a foul.
But the strategic switch failed to stop the Quakers as they went on to win 78-70. One of the keys to the victory was Wolf's fine defensive play on Howard Porter. The Wildcats joined a string of teams which have out-rebounded the Quakers, only to lose because of Penn's brilliant defense and clutch shooting. Dave Wall led all scorers with 22 points and 9 assists, and the happy guard had this to say about the victory.
"Well, it feels really good to win a second game over an excellent opponent like that. You always like to win the second meeting between two clubs after you've won the first, because it sort of proves that the first one was not just a fluke or something of that sort. It also proves that you were hungry enough to come back another year and at the same time with the same kind of championship on the line, and to just bring your competitive spirit out and win the thing again."
"We were happier to be beating Villanova than we were, I think, in winning the Big Five. And it was just a bonus that in beating Villanova in January of 1971, that was the final game, and we were crowned the Big Five champions that night."
Attention Penn basketball fans. Today is the start of the Penn Athletics Red and Blue Challenge, the department's annual giving competition. Penn basketball will be competing against other varsity programs for bonus funds based on most donors and most dollars raised. We hope you consider supporting the Red and Blue with a gift to the program today. Visit the link below for an overview of the challenge and to support Penn basketball. Go Quakers!
With a Big Five title wrapped up, the Quakers could now turn full attention to the Ivy League. Princeton invaded the Palestra hoping to avenge the 70-62 defeat suffered earlier at Jadwin Gym.
For anybody that was at Penn, you know, recruited by Digger Phelps, you know, when he talked about coming to Penn, the main thing that was put in your mind was we got to beat Princeton. So, I mean, from the day one on campus, that was a must-do, is to beat Princeton.
Every year, those Princeton games were close games. They were dogfights. And in many cases, they were games that put two teams that played against each other with very similar styles.
The Tigers fought the Quakers tooth and nail into the second half, and with their brilliant guard duo of Brian Taylor and Ted Manakis, built up a seven-point advantage with only 2:19 remaining. The stunned Palestra crowd turned frantic as it appeared that only a miracle could save the Red and Blue and their wins gain now. Coach Harter sent in guard Steve Bilski despite a pulled hamstring. Shortly afterwards, Dave Wall converted two free throws, cutting the lead to 56-51. He promptly stole the Tigers' inbounds pass and sank a layup. Penn regained possession and Dave Wall was again fouled. We pick up the action with a senior guard on the line.
He'll have to make the first one to get that second one. He does make it. And it's now 59-57. And we'll see if Wall intentionally misses so the Quakers can get the follow shot. 32 seconds to go. Wall's second shot is good. And it's 59-58. Quakers in the track press. Princeton with some quick passing breaks the press. And there's 29 seconds to go. Manakis in the backcourt. His double team has the ball knocked away, but gets it to Sickler. Now the pass goes back to Manakis. 22 seconds to go. Manakis dribbling around in circles against three Quakers. Now it goes down low to Stanzik. Stanzik back outside. Now Manakis has it. 14 seconds to go, and he is fouled by Dave Wall. So with 13 seconds to go, Manakis will be at the line. That's five personal fouls for Dave Wall. So the Quakers, if they're going to win, are going to have to do it without Wall, and they're going to have to hope that Manakis misses a shot here.
Manakis makes these two. It's just about ice for Princeton because Penn will have to get 3 points in only 13 seconds. If he does, he'll probably throw it up quickly, send somebody driving in and hope for a foul and a three-point play. If he makes one and misses one, Penn will set up a play in and have a chance to tie. If he misses the first, Penn has life. They could come back and have a chance to win.
So Manakis, who has done the job late in the game here from the foul line, he is 6-for-8 on the night altogether, has 16 points. There's a discussion in front of the scorer's table now. Coach Dick Harter standing there along with Al Cutler and Phil Hankinson and Bob Morse. Maybe some discussion as to the timeout situation.
Also, Dave, Coach Carrill wants that last foul to be an intentional foul on Dave Wall, which would give Ted Manakis two shots, not the one and one. And that's probably also what they were discussing.
So Ted Manakis with probably the two biggest foul shots of his young career at Princeton as the sophomore who was 6-for-8 from the line on the night. We'll try to make two here and probably ice the game for the Tigers. Manakis' first shot is up, and it's good, and it's 60-58 with 13 seconds to go, and if he makes the second, it could be all over for Pennsylvania. Second shot by Manakis is around, no good, rebound Craig Littlepage for Pennsylvania, and with 11 seconds to go, the Quakers call time. Steve, Coach Dick Harter is probably not the only one thinking about Corky Calhoun right now, as I'm sure the whole Princeton bench is thinking about Corky Calhoun, as they probably know as well as most Penn fans know that when the Quakers really get in trouble, they go to either Corky or Dave Wall, and since Dave Wall is out, Corky is the logical choice. So I think we're going to see Brian Taylor get a lot of help when Corky Calhoun gets the ball, if it does go to Corky.
It's a shame we're missing Steve Bilski, because Steve is great at these end-of-game situations. Penn will probably also drive. In case they miss, maybe they can pick up the foul. They will inbound all the way in the backcourt, but not at the end line, at the sideline, all the way in the back, and Princeton will pick them up full court to try to make them waste time.
Back in those days, there was no three-point shot, so, I mean, the best you could do is try to score two and tie the game.
Dave?
It's going to be difficult for the Quakers. They don't have their two best ball handlers in there, Bilski and Wall, and they'll try to get it into the forecourt. Al Kotler inbounds to Calhoun. He's going to bring it all the way in himself. Corky, 8 seconds to go to Hankinson. 6 seconds to go. Calhoun has it. Jump shot up. Good.
I got the ball at the top of the key, and I think the original design of the play was to dump it inside to Jim Wolf, who was our 6'8 center. He seemed to be covered, so I had to take the shot, and it was kind of strange. I still remember it to this day. It was almost as if all the noise stopped, and I was just launching the ball, float through the air, and it seemed like it took forever to get to the hoop. But it did score, and I remember running over to the huddle in the timeout. Dick Harter grabbed my hand, you know, real tight, in a sign of relief, maybe, or appreciation.
Well, you heard it. Corky Calhoun, with 1 second to go, takes a 25-foot jump shot from the top of the key, and Steve, it goes in.
Calhoun's buzzer bomb turned the momentum completely to the Quakers. When asked about the tying shot, the soft-spoken forward said,
"Okay, I remember we had the ball out. I think it was 13 seconds left on the clock. And the play was designed for either myself to, you know, try to take it all the way to the hoop and get a layup, possibly a three-point play, or to get the ball to Dave. And when I got the ball out, I dribbled down. I couldn't find any open man. And so I noticed I had the ball at the top of the key with about 3 seconds left on the clock. So I shot it up, hoped it would go in, and luckily it did."
In the overtime period, Penn still had trouble breaking the Tiger zone. With 1:13 remaining, Morse hit from 22 feet, and Bilski converted a 1-1. The Quaker defense held Princeton to 2 points, and the final score was 66-62. Wall and Calhoun were the Penn pace setters, each with 16 tallies, while Brian Taylor canned 21. A dejected coach, Pete Carroll, after viewing the miracle ending, remarked, "Nature is indifferent to the plight of man." The Quakers brought their Ivy League record to 5-0 as Penn routed Cornell 79-46. Although the Quakers played without Steve Bilski, it made little difference since Cornell's tallest player was 6'5". The Big Red briefly led 14-11 before Penn went on a 17-0 scoring streak to break open the game. 16 of those points were scored by the Earthquakers, who again impressed. Phil Hankinson paced the Quaker attack with 20 points. Next came Columbia.
Bilski hurt his ankle, and the big news on campus was who was going to start for the first time instead of Steve Bilski. And I was a junior. I got the start, and I remember how nervous I was. And I remember taking my first jump shot from the corner as a starter. And I felt so awkward and so out of sync. I felt like I didn't belong on the court, and somehow the jump shot went in. And that gave me confidence. And Dave Wohl was great. You know, he gave me confidence. He was the backcourt, the point guard. And he gave me a lot of confidence. So I remember the Columbia game well.
A team which was also undefeated in Ivy play. Pennsylvania posted a 92-79 victory over the Lions as the Quakers claimed undisputed first place in the Ancient Eight. Wohl, who popped in 21, and Bob Morse, who was Penn high scorer with 23, offset Columbia's big two of Larry Gordon and Elliott Wolfe with 48 between them. However, it was the phenomenal play of Jim Wolfe that did the damage, as the usually defensive-minded Ohioan pumped in 9 straight shots. Led by Wolfe and Calhoun, the Quakers completely dominated the boards, 51-31 overall. Pennsylvania continued its Ivy League binge by drubbing Brown, 70-56, in a game in which Steve Bilski guarded his 1,000th career point. Brown forced Penn into a horrendous first-half performance at Marvel Gym in Providence. The Quakers trailed 27-22 when a forearm by the Bruins' Bob Pratt aimed at Bilski, woke up the lethargic red and blue. The diminutive Bilski retaliated with an amazing offensive display as he scored 21 of his 23 points in the second half. Halfway through the Ivy schedule, the nationally fourth-ranked Quakers led the pack with a 7-0 record. On February 13th, the Quakers moved into New Haven for a game with the Bulldogs of Yale. With Calhoun, Hankinson, and Billingsley controlling the board, Penn had no trouble defeating the Elies 91-77. The Red and Blue returned home for the Harvard-Dartmouth weekend. The Crimson, with a 7-1 Ivy record, trailed Penn by a single game.
The Harvard, they were good, but we had beaten them pretty handily the other times we played them.
They just weren't as good as we were, especially at the guard positions. They had recruited two high school Americans, Floyd Lewis and James Brown, who were now going to be sophomores. And there was a lot of media talk how good they were going to be, and they were going to upset Penn and take over the Ivies.
That particular game, I was able to, get my jump shot going and was able to score more than I normally score.
It was just no contest, and I think they knew it too. I think their players knew that they just weren't in the same class as us that year.
But that game was a good game for me in terms of having my outside shot going. And we were able to beat them fairly easily. I think that was my career high at 10-28.
Animosity built between the two schools when Harvard mentor Bob Harrison boasted in print that his team would easily defeat Penn. The game figured to be a classic confrontation. The night belonged to Corky Calhoun. The muscular forward, although playing superb defense, had been an offensive enigma during the year. Corky delighted the fans by time after time taking Floyd Lewis to the hoop while scoring a career-high 28 points and grabbing 15 boards, leading a devastating Quaker attack, running Harvard out of the palestra 103-72. After the game, Coach Harter commented, "People talk about the superstars in town, including the two All-Americans, but I don't know if anyone could give us what Corky does." Even though there were 21-0, the Quakers had still failed to put two outstanding games back-to-back. The team accomplished that goal by taking Dartmouth apart 102-75, completing their weekend run. In so doing, they became the first Penn team since 1902 to score more than 100 points two games in a row and extended their Ivy winning streak to a record 24 straight. The following Friday, February 26th, Penn clinched a tie for the Ivy League title by playing just well enough to beat Brown 96-82 at the Palestra. In contrast to the game at Providence, the Red and Blue were never in real trouble. Steve Bilski regained his shooting touch to score 16 points. The Yale game was the Quakers' final Palestra appearance, and a win would clinch the Ivy title and NCAA berth. After Penn got off to a mediocre start, Bilski scored 7 straight points to make the lead 38-27. After that spurt, the Quakers were never headed. They coasted through the second half and at one stretch outscored Yale 24-4, with a final tally reading 93-63. The fans saw a unit composed of 5 seniors together at one time as Jim Haney scored a career high of 11 points. Bilski took the scoring honors with 16. The Quakers had their second Ivy crown in as many years and only 2 games away from a perfect season. Entering the final weekend of the campaign, most talk was about the upcoming tournament. But Harter would say nothing about that, pointing out that an unbeaten season was within grasp, and both remaining games were on the road. The first problem Penn faced was getting to Ithaca, as the bus stalled in a 15-foot snowdrift. Once they arrived at Cornell, there was no longer any challenge. The game was an easy victory, Penn immediately shooting to a 26-8 lead, and the Big Red never threatened. Penn had balanced scoring with five players in double figures while walking off with a 108-64 victory. It came down to the final game at Columbia's University Gym. Pennsylvania, 25-0, needed only this victory for a perfect season. Dave Wall summed up the feelings of the team.
We've all planned or hoped or worked for a perfect season from the beginning. Every college team does. And so right now, this game is sort of the culmination of it, and I think everyone just wants to go out and play the best possible to finish up the regular season with as impressive a victory as possible. And from there, we'll just take the NCAA one game at a time.
Columbia led in the early going, and with 6 minutes gone, Steve Bilski injured his knee and missed the remainder of the game. But the Quakers fought back for a 35-30 halftime lead. As in the past, Penn ignited in the second stanza, leading 60-40 at one instance, and coasted in 70-58.
1 second to go. Waters at the buzzer, no good. Final score, Pennsylvania 70, Columbia 58. The Quakers have won 26 straight on the year 1970-71, the first time ever that a Philadelphia school major college has gone undefeated in a regular season.
Hankinson and Morse were particularly effective, each getting 16 points and 9 rebounds. The perfect season dream became a reality that March evening in New York City. On to Morgantown. With the pressure of the regular season removed, the players and fans could contemplate the games past and the sudden death tournament to come. Craig Littlepage felt this way about the coming games.
Well, this is, it's really a gratifying feeling finishing a season 28-0. But keeping the whole thing in perspective, this is just the road to, a few other greater challenges. And, it's going to take a little bit more work on our part. We're going to have to work a little bit harder and, see what happens in the tournament.
As anticipation of the NCAA playoffs increased, the first-round pairings were announced. Penn was to take on the top Eastern Independent, Duquesne, in the Duke's own backyard, the little college and mining town of Morgantown, West Virginia, at the magnificent West Virginia University Coliseum. The sight of the game would mean that Duquesne fans would outnumber Penn rooters 4-1, and the Iron Dukes were noted for being very tough in front of home crowds. There was concern, too, over the extent of Steve Bilski's knee injury. Although it was diagnosed as only a wrench, the knee developed fluid, and by game time, Bilko was still not 100%. With a record of 21-3 and a 15-game winning streak, Duquesne coach Red Manning, shooting for his 200th career win, opened up with his regular starting lineup. The 6'10", 250-pound Nelson twin and Mickey Davis up front, and Jarrett Durham and Mike Barr at guard. This muscular team averaged 6'7 in height. The key man in the Duke attack appeared to be Davis. The 6'7 forward led the team in scoring and surprisingly rebounds and assists. He was considered to be a complete ball player in the Calhoun mold. For Penn, Bilski's absence from the starting lineup prompted Coach Harter to go with a Wall Calhoun backcourt and put Phil Hankinson up front. The new lineup sacrificed quickness, and Penn was really forced to play Duquesne on the Duke's own terms, strength against strength. By 7:30, March 13th, 13,861 fans, the largest crowd ever to see an NCAA first-round playoff game, had packed into the WVU Coliseum.
Tonight, in the first round of the Eastern Regional of the NCAA playoffs, Pennsylvania takes on the Iron Dukes from Duquesne. And tonight, Pennsylvania puts its whole season on the line, a 26-0 record, as they take to the hardwood against the Duquesne Dukes, coming in with a 21-3 record in the first round Eastern Regional of the NCAA playoffs.
In a man-to-man defense, not the zone that had been used all season. Responding, Bob Morse took Barry Nelson outside and hit 9 20-footers in the first half.
Penn sets up. It looks like Duquesne's playing a man-to-man. It goes to Morse. Bobby fakes one, puts the jump shot up good, and he was fouled. Nice play by Bob Morse as he went up very strongly and drew the foul from Barry Nelson. Still has it top of the circle to Bob Morse. Open 20-footer. It's good. Open is Bob Morse for 20-footer, and he makes it. So Penn grabs the lead again, 8-7, and Bob Morse has got all eight for the Quakers.
Manning said, "I was surprised. I had never seen him shoot that far out." But Penn fans knew better. The shooting of Morse and a surprising Penn rebounding edge gave Penn the lead at halftime. In the second half, Penn controlled but could not break the game open. But Duquesne could not catch up. The lead varied between 9 and 3 points.
4:44 to go in the game. Wall holding outside. Dribbles now to the right side. Drives baseline, has an opening. Goes all the way up too strong. Wolf gets the rebound. Taps to Morse. Morse to Jim Wolf. It comes to center court. And Wolf saves it. And he passes to Corky Calhoun. So the Quakers had a close call there but got the ball back. Calhoun top of the key dribbling the ball. Hands off to Dave Wall on the left side. Wall about 30 feet out against Durham, trying to work Calhoun. Low post, gets him the ball. Corky working, turns around, scoop shot up a good. Corky Calhoun behind his back and over his head. 11 points for Calhoun, and it's 61-56, 4 minutes and 5 seconds to go in the game. So Corky doing his job, getting the points late in the game. Nelson, low post, open is McHugh. He stops, can't get a shot off. Nelson doing a good job on him there. Now Wojnowski has the ball. Wolf slaps away. McHugh gets it back. McHugh runs Gilkey into a screen, goes all the way to the baseline, can't get a shot, has to come back outside to Jarrett Durham. Time is a-wasting, 3:45 to go. Wojnowski, 20-footer, it's good. And they left him alone, back of the foul line, about 18 feet out. And Wojnowski has 6 points, and McHugh has 8 points. That's 14 points for the Dukes off the bench. They trail by 3, 61-58.
As time waned, Penn went into the Bilski wall freeze.
Dave Wall has it now on the left side at the 25-foot line, just dribbling away the time, and it looks like the stall for the Quakers. 3:10 to go in the game now. Wall still dribbling, and Coach Red Manning wants McHugh to come over to double-team Dave Wall, and here he comes, and that goes back to Steve Bilski. So now Bilski will dribble over to the left 25-foot mark, and he will start dribbling the ball. 2:59 to go in the game now, and the Duke fans are booing. Bilski dribbling now to midcourt, now coming back to the 25-foot line. Almost loses the ball on the floor, controls, and McHugh's guarding him.
When it was apparent that Penn would be the victor, the frustrated fans from Pittsburgh threw bottles, bags, and animals onto the court. The final, Penn 70, Duquesne 65. The Penn players were finally relieved of the terrible burden that the loss to Niagara had placed on them. The emotion and release of tension in the locker room was tremendous. Coach Harter said, "This is the end of a very long year." The Quakers then moved on to the Reynolds Coliseum in Raleigh, North Carolina, for the Eastern Regionals. The draw matched them against the Atlantic Coast Conference champion, South Carolina, led by All-American guard John Roach.
And they featured four future NBA players. They decided to play their usual defense, which was a packed-in 2-3 to dominate the boards, and pretty much they dared us to shoot from outside over the zone. I was fine with that.
And center Tom Owens. Despite a 27-0 record entering the game, the red and blue fans were wary of playing the Gamecocks in ACC country. Villanova defeated Fordham, Digger Phelps' Cinderella team, and the opener of the regional twin bill. And then the Quakers took the court. The first half was extremely tight. Penn's tough man-to-man defense forced subpar shooting from the Gamecocks, who got most of their points on follow-ups by Owens and the rest of the tall front line. The lightning-quick Roche put Dave Wall in early foul trouble, forcing Corky Calhoun to cover the Gamecock ace. Bob Morse kept the Quakers in the game in the first half with 16 points as Penn trailed SC 37-36 at halftime.
56-52, and it's getting late, and Pennsylvania has a four-point lead. Roach. Calhoun's got him top of the key. Roach with a 20-footer. It's no good. Rebound. Trailer knocked away and controlled by Calhoun. And the Quakers have the ball with 8:35 to go. And the Quaker fans on the far side are going nuts. but there's a long way to go, and we see a substitution coming off the bench for Carolina. I believe Eidlett will make another appearance. He's got four fouls. He sat out most of the second half. Calhoun and Wall just playing catch on the left side now for Pennsylvania. And we may see McGuire get Carver in also to try to put some pressure. Carver, a very good defensive player. Morris, top of the key. That's a layup. It's good.
With 5 minutes remaining in the game, Penn held a 61-58 lead. Then the poised Quakers really took control. Wall canned a 1-1 and followed with another. Then Calhoun made two fouls, upping the score to 67-58.
And he makes the second. 67-58, 4:03 to go in the game. Roach in the forecourt. And what a job Calhoun's done on him. Roach runs into Steve Bilski. Offensive foul, John Roach. As Steve Bilski had position, technical foul on John Roach. As the New Yorker got really upset after that offensive foul was called. So we're going to have an offensive foul on Roach and a technical foul on Roach. And I believe Dave Wall will shoot the technical, and then the Quakers will get the ball.
Wall converted a moment later. Wall made another 1-1, and Bilski made two. Penn had completed an 11-0 run, all on foul shots, and led by 72-58.
Roach has got it. He's doing all the ball handling. Goes in on Calhoun, blocked by Calhoun, as Corky just stuffed it right down Roach's throat and knocked it out of bounds. As Corky wanted to let Roach know who's got control of this game.
The Quakers' defense choked the Gamecocks, coaxing them into errors and missed shots with a brilliant no-foul defense. The incomparable Dave Wall-Steve Bilski guard combination directed the hold offense, forcing the taller Southerners to foul themselves out of the NCAA playoffs. The final score was Penn 79, South Carolina 64. Morse wound up with 28 points, shooting 10 for 18 from the field. Wall had 20, hitting 10 for 11 from the line down the stretch. Corky added 10, but it was his outstanding defensive job on John Roach that was the difference in the game.
And it was a really satisfying win to beat the ACC tourney champion, South Carolina, on Tobacco Road by 15 points.
The Quakers, now 28-0 and ranked number 3 in the nation, had reached the emotional peak of the year, 2 days too soon. Prior to the Penn victory over South Carolina, the Villanova Wildcats defeated a good, hustling Fordham team in the first game of the Eastern semifinals. The Quakers would meet Villanova on Saturday afternoon for the Eastern Regional title and the opportunity to win the NCAA championship in Houston's Astrodome the following week. Just as Penn had reached an emotional peak in the victory over South Carolina, Villanova was pointing toward Pennsylvania. The Wildcats had pent up 3 years of frustration toward their crosstown rival, and the Cats seniors, Porter and Smith, were itching for one more chance to get even. Brilliantly and aggressively, Villanova controlled the first half. The Quakers were unable to penetrate Jack Kraft's ball defense, and atypically, Bilski, Wall, and Calhoun were trying to force the ball inside where offensive opportunities did not exist. Along with this, Bob Morse was effectively contained by Hank Simontowski. As a result of the sputtering offense, the Quakers made numerous costly turnovers when field goals were desperately needed. Complementing their tenacious defense, Villanova shot extremely well from the field. Led by Howard Porter, the Wildcats shot 55% in the first half. Even when Villanova missed, the aroused Porter or Clarence Smith would invariably get an offensive rebound and score an easy field goal. For the 500-odd Penn students who made the trip to Raleigh, it was a devastating experience. Frustration and resentment had become complete when toward the end of the first half, the hated Wildcats went into a semi-stall to prevent Penn from closing the gap. The halftime score was Villanova 43, Penn 20. If it was a devastating experience for the fans, it had to be even worse for the players. The Quakers had been down before at Ohio State, at Harvard, and against Princeton. The squad was prepared to come from behind again with an all-out effort in the second half. But the Villanova momentum continued through the final 20 minutes as they scored the first 16 points of the second period. The red and blue were simply unable to contain the Villanova onslaught. Unmercifully, Porter, Ford, Simankowski, Smith, and Inglesby continued to pour it on until the final buzzer. Howard Porter took his full measure of revenge by shooting 16 for 24 for 35 points. No Penn player was in double figures. The season ended for Penn with a final score, Villanova 90, Penn 47.
Well, no doubt about it, you know, this past year was, you know, filled with successes and happiness as far as the team's concerned. And even considering what happened in the last game, I think if you look at it reasonably, we have to consider it a successful year. But I'm not going to talk too much about what we did last year, because what happened yesterday doesn't count anymore. It's I think we should look forward to next year. And I know for a fact, as soon as after we lost to Villanova, in fact that day, Phil Hankson, myself, and a couple of the other guys who were not seniors, we went out to eat after the game. You know, of course we're upset over it, but it's funny how we didn't really dote upon that game. We were talking mostly about the upcoming year, which I think is a good sign. I think this upcoming year, of course, we'll lose Steve, Dave, and Jimmy, which, you know, is going to hurt. But I think we have a couple of good sophomores coming up, and I think we still have the nucleus of a very good team, and I think that we can go as far this year as we did last year, if not farther.
And so the glory ended for Penn, but the glory of 28 straight wins could never be forgotten. The 1970-71 Penn basketball team set many records, but perhaps it could feel most proud of the fact that the team accomplished one goal that no other Big Five team has ever achieved, an unbeaten season. Even the great LaSalle, Villanova, St. Joe, and Temple teams of the past lost at least one game in the regular season. Penn did not. Several weeks after the sting of the final defeat had worn off, Pennsylvania fans received a new shock. Coach Dick Harter, the architect of the perfect season, resigned his job to assume a new challenge as coach of the University of Oregon in the Pacific 8. Ray Edelman and Dick Stewart followed Harder west. And so the break with the past was nearly complete. Dave Wall, Steve Bilski, Jim Wolfe, Jim Haney, John Kohler, and Dick Harter had all left the Penn scene. As winter approaches again, thoughts turn to the upcoming season. Two new coaches, Chuck Daly and his assistant, Rolly Massimino, have arrived, and veterans like Calhoun, Morse, Cutler, Hankinson, and Little Page return. We asked Coach Daly to talk about the season that begins Wednesday.
Perhaps Penn is embarking on the most difficult collegiate basketball schedule they've ever attempted. When you start adding outside opponents like Duke and Durham, North Carolina, where I was an assistant for 6 years, know how tough it is to get down there and get the job done, play Western Kentucky and Louisville, go to the Kodak Classic and play Southern California in preseason ranked number one. Then in addition, your tough Big Five opponents, where no matter what the difference in the caliber of the teams might be, they're going to be difficult basketball games. Then you take a look at the Ivy League. And perhaps it's as strong as it's been in its history. So we're embarking on, I think, a very, very difficult schedule.
Well, in going against that schedule, we have a lot of returning talent from last year. Why don't you go over some of the key men in Penn basketball for the season?
Right, Steve. While we do have a lot of people returning, we only have two starters returning. But I'm not crying by any measure and means. I think we have some talented people. I know we're going to miss some of the people, but that's in the past. Right now, we're looking to a certain hardcore of people. Up front, we've got to think in terms of Craig Littlepage, Phil Hankinson, and Bobby Morris. These people are proven players. They played a great deal last year. And by playing these people up front, we can move Corky to the backcourt, and that's where we've been playing him along with Alan Cotler. These people right now are doing a good job of heading up the situation, which could change on a daily basis. People that are contesting for positions are Ron Billingsley at a forward, Jablonski at center, Philadelphia boy, and Whitey Varga at the guard position primarily. These people right now look like they have the best chance at this point in time in our preseason practice.
Returning freshman coach Ray Carrazzo spoke of the new sophomores who will contribute to the Penn varsity this year.
This year, four players from last year's freshman team made the varsity. John Jablonski was our leading scorer last year on the freshman team, and Whitey Varga was our second leading scorer. We anticipate that John Jablonski will give Craig Littlepage a very good battle for the center position on this year's varsity team, and I know that John will contribute heavily to the varsity this year. In the backcourt, Whitey Varga and Alan Cotler have been splitting up the guard duties, and we anticipate a very good year from Whitey and a great deal of contribution to the team effort. Two other players that have made the varsity are Billy Finger and Jack Sonnenberg from last year's freshman team, and they are both guards.
In 2 days, the new season, with its own share of surprises, highlights, and frustrations, will begin. But the trend toward success, the winning tradition that was established in December 1968, firmly entrenched. We're all still living in an era of greatness for Penn basketball.
Penn had played so poorly before, it was almost considered like the Big Four in Penn.
And when basketball took off and when we became a national power, it changed the campus.
I still have, you know, friends from Penn that were players, but have lifelong memories of some of the experiences we had as a team.
And then when we started, our team started to grow and play really well, the Penn fans, it was like they were ready to burst, and they just let it out. And they became loud. They screamed every game. They pumped us up.
And our students there at Penn really, I think, appreciated, you know, the success that we had as a team.
You know, when we would go to away games, there'd always be 50 to 100 kids following us in the hotel. There was a unifying effect on campus, even with many of the professors.
Now, that was a great experience for us players. Both of the same thing.
Clearly that season individually was a lot of fun. I got to share that season with a terrific coaching staff and just a great group of individual people who were my teammates.
I feel more and more blessed to have been a part of that great 70-71 team. I'm also very grateful to have had such exceptional teammates and coaches, which who helped me develop my game.
And what I really felt proud of in looking back was we set a foundation for Penn basketball to be great going forward. Everybody coming in, you know, got sort of indoctrinated, like, this is how you do things. We win. We go out and we win games. And it didn't have anything to do with whether we were Ivy Leaguers or where we played or anything. I think we just put this foundation for how to be an elite team together. And when you can influence people in that manner for the next 20 or 30 years, and Penn basketball rightly put down a foundation of just greatness, I think that's really, for me, it's really enjoyable.